So the key question, how many patient specimens need to be retested? There aren't very many evidence-based recommendations for how to do this. I might say there are actually none, and we hope to help you with the C24 document. There are a couple of approaches that labs can take. You could retest all the patient specimens back to when your QC was last in control. Or you could retest patient specimens until the point in time when the error occurred. Retesting patient specimens until the last good or in control QC is pretty straightforward. So here I've shown good QC with your green diamond. The failed QC at the next QC measurement is in the red diamond. In between, each of those stick figures might represent 2, 10, 20 patient results. And you can see that we've gone back, because we had a QC failure, we've gone back and repeated all of the patient tests, and the red ones are the ones that had to be corrected. This approach is good in situations where you're doing batch testing. Maybe you're doing bracketed QC, or you have a situation where the QC testing intervals are short, and you're not actually testing very many patients between QC events, because then it's practical. We have situations in our lab where we might do 200 to 400 patient samples an hour, and this is not a practical approach. So for high volume labs, I would propose retesting patient specimens in batches. And this is actually the approach that we use in our laboratory at the Mayo Clinic. We retest patients in batches until we get to a batch where no error is encountered. And by error, I mean that there's no change in the result that's considered clinically significant based on that criteria we've established. So again, each of these stick figures might represent 2, 3, 4 patients. In our laboratory, we actually retest in batches of 10 patient specimens. That's not a magic number, but it's something that has worked for us. So you can see in this first batch, we retested 5 patients, 4 out of the 5 results needed to be revised. So we would then go back 5 more. I will say 5 is probably too small because you might miss that. I would do a batch of at least 10. But in this case, 3 out of the 5 needed correction. So we went back another 5, and we didn't have to revise any of those results. What that tells us is the error occurred somewhere in that time frame, or at least we can estimate that it's somewhere around there, and the risk of incorrect results before that time frame becomes quite low. So how many patient specimens need to be retested? Well, we don't know the answer to that until we start recovering. We want to retest patient specimens until the point in time that the error occurred, or at least close to that point of time. And another important consideration is that retesting must include specimens with concentrations near the concentration of the QC failure. I bring that up for special analytes where either the concentration of the analyte spans a large range, such as glucose. If my level 3 QC failed, and that's at a glucose of 200, but the last 10 patients were all at glucoses of 90, I want to make sure and go back and cover those concentrations where the QC failure occurred. Other examples are things like cardiac troponin T, where perhaps the last 10 samples were all undetectable cardiac troponin T. I want to make sure to go back in time to the point where I had measurable cardiac troponin T concentrations, so that we aren't thinking we discovered the error only because we had a whole bunch of patients that did not have an MI. What if retesting patient specimens isn't possible? The reasons might be that the quantity is not sufficient for retesting, or maybe that the analyte isn't stable over time. We still need to treat these as errors, as out-of-control conditions and erroneous results. Corrections still need to occur, and in the electronic medical record, it should be documented that this result is not valid. You can say something about routine quality assurance processes in the lab detected an issue, therefore the result is not valid. You may, depending on your institution's policies, you may need to credit that charge or order for a recollection of the sample. But these considerations need to be part of the QC plan and also the QC frequency. I also oversee COAG. We have a few analytes, or the general COAG. We have a few analytes where the samples are only stable for 4 hours. They're pretty low volume tests, but we need to factor in that our QC then should probably be done at a frequency of every 3 hours, so we don't run into a problem that a sample has expired and then we catch an analytic issue and there's nothing we can do about it. The next phase that I think that's important that we need to think about is ongoing assessment. And what that means is asking the question, is your QC program working? What types of problems is QC detecting? Commonly, it's the need for calibration or changing an electrode or a reagent lot issue. But also ask, how many out-of-control QC conditions occur each month? Are certain analytes more problematic? And how many patient specimens required retesting versus how many reports were corrected? I give you a generic example here of Lab A and Lab B that both had to retest 200 patient specimens in a month due to out-of-control conditions. However, Lab A only had to correct 10 patient results, and Lab B had to correct 180. If I'm Lab A and I review this data, I might say, I have a high false rejection rate. I'm repeating a lot of patient results when there's an out-of-control condition that don't need revision, and I might want to review the QC rules that I'm using. If I direct Lab B, I'm going to say, that's a pretty high correction rate, and I might want to review my QC frequency, review my rules that are used, and try to get rules that would give me better error detection. The other question that I don't know if we always ask, but I think it's important to ask, is what is QC missing? We know what it's catching, but what is it missing? Are there other instrument issues, results that we've corrected for other reasons that QC didn't catch, physician complaints, technologists observed defects? The techs are the experts. They know what's going wrong in the lab. Ask them. External quality assessments. Did we fail proficiency testing, but yet our QC was just fine that day? And when we find those issues, let's perform root cause analysis and ask ourselves, can we somehow modify our quality control plan that next time this error occurs, we're able to detect it? So in summary, I hope I've convinced you that labs need robust error detection methods, but they need more than that. And response and recovery to out-of-control conditions has to be real-time, and it has to be patient-centric. And QC programs also need ongoing assessment to be effective. And asking those questions, both what is my QC detecting, how well is it working, but also what is QC missing? So I thank you for your attention. And I think we'll finish up with questions.